everyone, I'm Heather Ginsburg, and welcome to San Antonio Water Systems H2Oaks Center.
We are on over 6,000 acres out here at H2Oaks, and we have three water sources. We pull water from the local Carrizo Aquifer, we pull brackish groundwater from the Wilcox Aquifer, and this is also the site of our Aquifer Storage and Recovery Center. We have several no-mo zones out here at H2Oaks, where we have planted native prairie grasses and native wildflowers to restore the habitat that was once here before us. And most of this land is still used in the same way it has been used for decades, because we leased the land back to the original farmers and ranchers that we bought it from. Before we get started, I want to share with you that this building was designed to tell you a very important, timeless story.
There are plenty of clues along the way, and let's see if you can figure out what that very important story is. Come on in, let me show you around. Welcome inside. I shared with you that this building was designed to tell you a very important story. There's plenty of clues in here. I want to see if you can figure out what that story is. Come on in. So, did you figure it out yet? We wanted to tell you the story of the water cycle in a timeless way, passively, that was open to your interpretation of what you saw. So I hope you picked up on the clues. The first one being the water on the wall, because the water cycle begins with evaporation. Of course, that water turns to water vapor in gas form, and it ends up in the clouds. The clouds up there are different colors to demonstrate that each cloud may be holding a different amount of water. Of course, we have condensation after that, and precipitation demonstrated by the light fixtures. And then very importantly, we have the yellow shade sails demonstrating the sunshine, because the sun is how the water cycle gets its energy. Now the water cycle is a very nice segue, because the water cycle is nature's desalination process, right? When water evaporates off the ocean, it doesn't come back down as super salty rain, does it? So this is a nice segue to then learn all about the man-made desalination process that we are all about to see together. Let's go check it out. This is the tour corridor, and this was a very important consideration when we were designing this building, because as you all are gonna see in just a few minutes, inside the reverse osmosis room behind the glass, we call that the RO room for short, it is really, really loud. So all of the reverse osmosis equipment behind glass allows us to have this beautiful, nice, quiet tour corridor where you could actually hear what I'm saying. You guys are gonna get to see where the water comes into the plant in just a second, but let me show you its first stop. When the raw water comes into the plant, that's the feed water or untreated water from the wells. When it comes into the plant, its first stop is the testing panel. We need to test what's coming into the plant to see what we got. And there's a lot of parameters that the water operators take into consideration, and the equipment is highly automated. So when water comes into the plant, we're testing for all kinds of things, pH, turbidity, all of that stuff. And if something is out of spec, the plant will actually shut down. We need to test the water coming into the plant before it goes into the rest of the process, because our equipment is really expensive and we do not want anything moving through our reverse osmosis membranes that could be harmful to them. The second stop is the pre-filters. So you'll see the big silver drums. Inside each one of those silver drums, there are several of these pre-filters, okay? The pre-filters are less expensive than the reverse osmosis membranes, and their job is to capture all of the suspended solids, okay? So when it comes to producing water and you have wells in the ground, sometimes when you bring that water up, there's debris in it, okay? There might be some mud in there. There might be some little rocks in there. We need to capture that through these pre-filters, okay? You will see here is a nice clean one, and here is a dirty one. And their job is to remove all of the suspended solids and all of the muck and the grit. Next, that water needs to move under the floor to the pumping room, just like our hearts pump blood all over our bodies. The pumps here at the desalination plant pump the water all throughout the plant. So not only do they boost the pressure significantly so the water can move through the reverse osmosis process and through all those membrane elements, they also control the movement of the water throughout the entire plant and out of the plant as well. Here at the desalination plant, we use variable speed pumps, and that allows us to save a little bit of energy along the way. We are on over 6,000 acres out here at H2Oaks. We have several brackish groundwater wells that are pulling water from the Wilcox Aquifer. Now, all of those wells are sprinkled all over the property, and outside of the building, pipes converge and all of the brackish groundwater enters into one pipe and comes straight into the building right here. Let's do a fun test together. Okay? First, I'm going to share with you that brackish water can be measured on something called the total dissolved solids scale. Okay? That scale measures how many total dissolved solids are in the water, how much salt and minerals are in the water. Brackish water is anything that falls between 1,000 milligrams per liter and 10,000 milligrams per liter on the TDS scale. What do you think that the brackish water from the Wilcox is going to measure on the TDS scale? Any guesses? Let's give it a second. And here you can see that the raw water that is coming into the plant from the Wilcox is measuring at approximately 1500 on the TDS scale. Remember, anything that measures between 1000 and 10,000 is considered to be brackish water. This water is only measuring 1500. So here at our desalination plant, we call this water barely brackish. Guys, it's not really that salty at all. And that is what makes it advantageous for SAWS to have our desalination plant located on the H2Oaks campus. It takes a lot less energy, a lot less wear and tear on our equipment to desalinate this brackish water compared to, say, seawater from the ocean that would be measuring somewhere around 35,000 milligrams per liter on the TDS scale. When you are looking at the reverse osmosis equipment, you will notice there are several long linear white tubes. Each one of those is called a pressure vessel. Now, you'll notice there's a lot of those white pressure vessels. They are all arranged on what is called a skid or a train. Inside each pressure vessel, there are seven membrane elements stuffed in end to end. Now in real life, these membrane elements are about 40 inches long. This one has been cut away so you can see what they look like inside. You'll notice that there are so many membranes. Now that is where the brackish water has to pass through, making its way towards the middle. And with every membrane that it passes through, it's leaving all of the minerals and salts behind. By the time that the water reaches the middle, it is the permeate. So we start out with one stream of water, which is the raw water that we're pulling straight from the Wilcox Aquifer. And once it moves through the pressure vessels, it separates the water into two streams. One of those streams is called permeate, and one of those streams is called concentrate. Permeate is the water that doesn't have any total dissolved solids in it anymore. Okay, in other words, that water is squeaky clean of all of the salts and minerals. The other stream of water is called concentrate, and it's just like how it sounds, a high concentration of the salts and the minerals. We don't stop there. One of the things that makes our desalination plant very unique is we have a three-stage reverse osmosis process. This allows us to get to 90% efficiency at our plant. What that means is that of all the water that comes into this plant, 90% of it leaves to be treated and become drinking water. Only 10% is left as the byproduct of this process. Three stages is really quite simple to explain. All we're doing is after that water separates into two streams after the first pass, we run that concentrate through again. That's second stage. In other words, we got that water here. We had to expend electricity and manpower to get it into the building. Why don't we try to squeeze even more permeate out of it? Let's try to get more water out of it. So we run the concentrate through again, that second stage. But we don't stop there either. We run it through for a third and final time. And this is how we are able to achieve 90% efficiency at our H2Oaks desalination plant. Let's head down and talk about where the permeate leaves the building to be treated to send out to distribution. And let's also go and see where the concentrate leaves the building and heads out to the deep injection wells to be disposed of safely. Come on. Okay, so now the water has been through the entire three-stage reverse osmosis process. And now let me show you where the two water streams leave the building, okay? The concentrate is the byproduct of the process. It is going to be leaving the building through this pipe right here. It is going to be traveling all the way out in the field to our injection wells, where it's going to be injected over a mile deep underground. Over here is where the other water stream is going to leave, the water that we're going to send out to distribution. And that water, remember, is called permeate, and it is going to leave through this pipe. You'll notice that the pipe that carries the permeate is a lot bigger in diameter than the pipe that takes out the concentrate. Because remember, 90% of all the water that comes into the desalination plant is going to leave as usable water to send out to distribution. Remember our little test at the beginning where we tested the total dissolved solids of the raw water or feed water coming into the plant from the Wilcox aquifer. Remember it was barely brackish and it measured at 1500 milligrams per liter on the TDS scale. Now let me ask you this, what do you think the permeate, that's the finished water that's leaving the building, what do you suspect that the permeate is going to measure on the TDS scale? Let's find out. It's very easy to see with this bright color here that the permeate is measuring zero on the TDS scale. This water is pristine. Pretty much every last bit of salts and minerals have been removed from it. The water has left the building and it's pristine. Why couldn't we just put it into our distribution system at this point? Because historically, our city was 100% reliant on the Edwards Aquifer water. The Edwards Aquifer water is hard water, okay? It has a lot of total dissolved solids in it, about 350 to 400 milligrams per liter, I've been told, okay? We have got to make this water chemically match the Edwards water before we ever put it in our distribution system. This is critically important. We have to make it match. So how we do that is we add calcite back into the water. So we remove all of the minerals and then we need to add a little bit back in, is basically how it works. Okay, so this is simply just calcium carbonate. It's food grade. Of course it's food grade because it's gonna be consumed by humans, right? It's going back into the distribution system. And basically it feels like, kind of feels like salt, oddly enough, but it's just little bits of calcium. We put that back in the water to condition the water to make it match the Edwards, and then and only then do we ever release this into our distribution system. Welcome to the lab at H2Oaks, everybody. The lab is a very important part of what we do because it is in the lab that we have ongoing testing every single day to make sure that our water is safe to drink. Now, you guys are very lucky today because on a normal on-site tour, we don't go inside the lab. Today we are. Come on inside. I'm excited to introduce you all to Howard Hart. He is one of our operators here at SAWS, and he's going to demonstrate one of the many experiments that happen in the lab every single day. Hi, Howard.
Hi, Heather. How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
Great. Okay, so what we're going to talk about today is the calcium hardness test, because when we make water with a reverse osmosis system, we essentially take things like calcium hardness out. And so we're going to need to put some of that back in to make it match Edwards aquifer water. So to start with, I'm going to take some of the water. I'm going to take exactly 50 milliliters. These are very exact tests, talking about exact the amount of parts per million. So essentially, I'm going to work with a couple of chemicals here. Now I'm going to take another chemical called phenolphthalein. And that phenolphthalein will change colors as the pH changes. So the fact that it can change colors and the exact amount that I put in here will give me the amount of calcium hardness in the water. Gives me a result of 137 milligrams per liter of calcium hardness, which is a good number.
Wow, Howard, that was super cool. I hope you got the answer that you were looking for. What would have happened if you got a different result?
Well, we'd make a process control change because obviously we're controlling how much calcium hardness comes out of the plant in the long run.
Thank you so much, Howard.
You're quite welcome. Thank you, Heather.
We are in the operator's control room, and this is where the magic happens. So in this control room, we are able to control all three water sources that are here at H2Oaks Center. I am really happy to introduce you to Sherry Jaggi. She is one of our experienced operators here at H2Oaks, and she's gonna share with us how much water we are producing today.
Today we're doing 35 million gallons of water.
Now it's important to remember that the amount of water that we produce is dynamic and it varies day to day, month to month, and seasonally. There are certain times of the year where we don't have a need to produce that much water, but today we are producing a lot. So Sherry is looking very relaxed here in the control room right now. This control room is highly automated. She's monitoring all of the equipment for all of those water sources. However, if an alarm goes off and there is something going on with a well out there, for example, it's also Sherry that's gonna go hop in the truck quickly and go tend to that well and fix it or do whatever she's gotta do.
In this control room, we're watching all types of stuff. We're watching pumps, we're watching wells, we're watching flows. You name it, we're watching it.
Man, these men and women that work out here are working hard. Thank you so much, Sherry.
Thank you.
When SAWS built this desalination plant, they built it to diversify our water portfolio and secure our water for the future. And they also built it for expansion. SAWS was very innovative, and they were building this building and this plant anyways, that they decided to leave a little room for the future. If we ever need to expand this desalination plant, we already have the floor poured, the pipe step-ups are there for the pumps and everything. And we're up and running, almost doubling our capacity and putting out several million more gallons a day of water for our citizens of San Antonio. Thank you so much for joining us on our tour of H2Oaks Center today. We hope you enjoyed it and learned a lot along the way.